Can we cut the music in the back, please? We're getting started out here.
All right. Our Father, our King, Father, we just thank you, Father, for being with us today, Father, and for this week. We thank you for this congregation, for this community that you've brought us all to, Father. Father, as we continue throughout this night, Father, may you have your hand on Bill. May you speak through him, Father. Speak the words that we need to hear, Father. May you open up our eyes, our ears, and our hearts at this time so that we may hear your voice, Father, that we may be your image bearers to those around us. Father, I thank you for bringing each one of us here at this appointed time. Father, I thank you for your son, Yeshua, and the sacrifice that he was for us, Father. Amen.
Okay, you may be seated. I have just a couple of quick announcements. Is the rest of our family with us out there, guys, in the back? Yay, we're live. Okay. Hey, rest of the family, we want to make sure you were with us before I started any announcements. Sorry we were a minute or two late, but we're glad you're with us. So the one announcement that I have is We do have some seats left for the Seder meal. Not a ton, but we do have some seats left. So check your email for the Passover link. There was an email, I think it was the 23rd, that it went out. It has the Passover registration link in there, so you can sign up for the Seder there. Also, you can sign up to attend the regular just service. But there is a cost for the Seder meal. So that's the one that we kind of have limited seats left on that. So if you don't, if you didn't get the email, you can also sign up on any of our links on our social media platforms. So if you have any questions or have any difficulties, just call the office. It's a beautiful time, and we hope that all of you can join us. So snag one of those last few seats. So that's the only announcement that I had. The other thing was a prayer request that Robert just brought to my attention. I didn't get a lot of details. It is a young man who is a teenager who was apparently just removed from his home. And it's a sad situation, and I don't have a name. I just know that we were asked to pray for the whole situation, the whole family. And I don't know all the details, but we're going to pray whatever mom and dad need to do to get the family back together, that they'll work on and do that, and that this young man will, the father will just keep him protected and in the best possible scenario until the family is in a healthy enough situation that they can be reunited. So again, I really don't have any other details other than that, so think about this young man when you pray and keep him and his family in your prayers, if you will. So as I said, this was just brought to my attention right before the service tonight. So apparently it's a very recent thing. So anyway, we will go ahead and release for our groups now for our Miss Nayla. Treasures. All those beautiful treasures who blessed us so much on Shabbat. Y'all did a great job. Miss Nayla and her team is waiting for you. All of our treasures. There they go. Okay. Quiver. You want junior or senior first? Junior Quiver. General Rhodes is waiting for you. He was excited to go. Bill already has his coffee tonight in hand before he gets to the stage. It's going to be a real humdinger tonight. Either that or he's just extra tired. He's not answering me. He's not even blinking his eyes. Now I'm scared. Okay, do we have all of our junior quiver out? Senior quiver, General Dahl is waiting for you. And there goes the other half of the room. Okay, Mr. Cloud. What do you need? It's over here.
Say something while I'm getting
it. He wants me to say something while he's getting the stool. So what do y'all want to talk about? What'd y'all have for lunch today? The streamers, y'all are just posting all the good stuff. Hey, you know what? Speaking of the streamers posting, so he said say something. That was his first mistake. And I have the microphone. On Shabbat, when we were praying and everybody was bringing up the names and putting them in the treasure box, it was so beautiful. I don't know if y'all have had a chance to go back and watch any, but if you get a chance, go back and watch what the rest of our family was doing out there, because while we were pouring in physically right here, putting the names in the box, they kept that screen just rolling, rolling, rolling with all the names that were coming up. So we have a lot of praise reports to look forward to. But if you didn't get to see that, go back and watch it. It really blessed me to see that.
All right. Good evening. How are y'all doing? Have y'all met this young man over here in the red shirt? I looked out there on Shabbat, and I'm like, who is that guy sitting next to Joanna? Something looks different about him. But anyway. All righty. Well, I hope you've had a good afternoon. Good day. I'm a little clumsy tonight. So we're going to continue on with the book of Romans. Still working in chapter 8. Says session 28. Wow. That's amazing. So we're going to pick up where we left off last week in verse 14. And I'm going to spend a good bit of time talking about a concept here in this verse. But it says, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. So if all that Paul has argued in all the previous chapters up until this point is true, and we believe it is, in other words, being led by the Spirit enables us to put to death the deeds of the flesh. And the deeds of the flesh, of course, are brought on by a carnal mind. And a carnal mind is at war with God. So all these things that he's been talking about, if those are true, then being led by the Spirit of God is evidence that we belong to him, that we are his sons and his daughters. So there's several passages that kind of echo this same or address this same truth, maybe a little differently. And one that came to mind was a very familiar portion of scriptures in John chapter 1, in verse 12 and 13. It says, but as many as received him, that is the Messiah, who is the incorruptible seed, to them he gave the right. And that Greek term means power, it means ability, it means authority. And notice this phrasing, to become children of God. But as many as received him, he gave them the right to become children of God, to those who believe in his name, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. And so just, you know, think about what John is saying there, and then the statement in verse 14, as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. And so being led by the Spirit of God is, it goes hand in glove with receiving him, being, you know, being born again and being that new creation, along with it goes this right and this ability to become the children of God. So then, the Spirit of God is absolutely necessary, mandatory, if we are going to serve God in an acceptable way. Because the Spirit of God enables us to do what we would otherwise not be able to do, not in and of our own power. Because the Spirit of God enables us to die to the fleshly impulses. Doesn't mean we don't have them. It doesn't even mean that we don't at times give in to them. It just means that he's given us the power to overcome those things. And so when we continue to be led by the Spirit of God, we resist the inclination to be conformed to the world. For all our spiritual bravado about how we don't want to be, you know, conformed to the ways of the world, every day we conform to the ways of the world. We do things without even thinking about it sometimes. But the Spirit of God, you know, as we grow and mature, prompts us in different things. For instance, something I've said many times, and I'll continue to use myself as the example. The things that God is dealing with me about now are much, I feel anyway, are deeper than the things that he was dealing with me about 35 years ago. You know, the things that he was dealing with me about 20 years ago compared to now, it gets more intense. And things that I would not have considered 25, 30 years ago, really. But it's about the Spirit of God leading us and directing us not to be conformed to the world. Because later on in this same chapter, Paul is going to say that if we are in Messiah, we are being conformed to the image of the Son of God, who was not of this world in everything that he did. So John says, in a different way of putting it, but that in Messiah, You and I have been given a right, which, again, which is a power, and it's an ability to become the children of God. And if to become the children of God, which that's always kind of intrigued me, and I know that there are different opinions as to what he was really getting at, but if you consider that we are being conformed to the image of the Son of God, does that not imply that this is a process, right? Because we're still in this mortal, corruptible body right now, right? We've been born again, but we're still in this corruptible body. There are things yet to transpire. So again, we've been given the right, we've been given the power, we've been given the ability to become the children of God. And that implies, and this is the point, that you and I have a role to play in this process. We have a cost that is incurred that we have to pay, as we were talking about this past Shabbat. The Spirit of God is the one who initiates the process, but we have to be willing to follow his lead. And as I was kind of working on this, I thought about this. This kind of gets into the groom-bride aspect of things. In our world, on this level, biblically speaking anyway, the man initiates and the woman responds. Now, I know that today's feminist would, you know, have a flying duck fit over that statement right there. And if you don't know what a flying duck fit is, we'll talk about it later. Anyway, but biblically speaking, the way God designed things is the man is to initiate and the woman is to respond. So by that, the woman can say yes or no. So if he's the groom and we're the bride, he initiates the process, but we still have the choice to make. Are we going to be led by you or we are not going to be led by you? And of course, by default, if we're not led by him, we're going to be led by our flesh. And that gets into all these other things that Paul has talked about. So as the children of God, then we have to be led by the Spirit. We are not to lead the Spirit of God. Is there any scripture to support the notion that we tell the Spirit what to do? Can you think of any passage of scripture where we would do that? Well, that's even implied. I can't think of one. But is there not plenty of scripture to support the idea that we must be willing to allow the Spirit of God to lead and tell us and give us direction, give us guidance? So again, he initiates the process, but it falls to us to respond to what he leads us to do. For example, in Matthew chapter 4, it says that Yeshua was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by Satan, which is kind of an interesting thing. The Spirit of God leads the Messiah into an environment whereby he was going to be tempted by Satan. In fact, that was the whole idea, for him to be tempted by Satan. And what was the temptation? Any ideas? Okay. There's a way I want you to see this. That's true. But the temptation was this: to see if Yeshua would be led by the Spirit or if he would be led by the adversary. Okay? The Spirit of God led him into the wilderness, and the temptation was to see if he would be led by the adversary. Because what is the adversary continually doing in that exchange they had? If you are the Son of God, then do what I'm telling you to do. He did that three times. If you are the Son of God, you want to prove you're the Son of God, then do what I'm telling you to do. And if he had done what Satan was urging him to do, that would have negated the fact that he was the Son of God, right? Now, I mean, even saying that, that sounds almost, ugh. But you understand, he had to be tempted in these ways. So he was being driven into the wilderness, led into the wilderness by the Spirit of God to be tempted of Satan, to see if he could be and would be led by the adversary. Of course, he did not. He resisted him each and every time, quoted scripture to him, and then sent him on his way. And as a footnote to that, for a season. He went away for a season, which means what? He's coming back, right? So that means that winning a battle doesn't mean the war is over. There are going to be others. You know, it would be great to think that this is the final battle. After this, it's all over with, and we're on easy street, and we'll coast the rest of the way. And I don't think that's going to happen. Winning a battle doesn't mean that the war is over. It just means that we have been given an opportunity to learn lessons, to overcome, to be strengthened, to be challenged for the next battle. And the next battle might be a little bit more intense than the previous one. And so then, as children of God, those who are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. As the sons and daughters of God, here's one of the things that we have to kind of resign ourselves to, and that is that we're going to have to daily, sometimes hourly, crucify our flesh. Depending on the circumstances, we may have to continually crucify our flesh by the hour, certainly by the day. But doing this on a consistent basis, not just hit and miss, but doing this on a consistent basis is evidence that we are being led by the Spirit. Because again, the Spirit of God empowers and enables us to do what we could not otherwise do, and that is to resist the inclination to be led by the flesh. And this is something that, you know, Paul doesn't speak about it just in Romans. He speaks about in other passages of Scripture, sharing this with other congregations. And so I'm going to share with you from Galatians 5 in verse 16 through 18. He says this, walk in the Spirit. In other words, be led by the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another. In other words, they're at enmity with one another. They're at war with one another. The carnal mind is at war with God because it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. So the Spirit of God and the flesh are at war with one another. So be led by the Spirit, walk in the Spirit, do not fulfill the lust of the flesh. The flesh lusts against the Spirit against the flesh. These are contrary to one another. Why? So that you do not do the things that you wish. So if I want to do it, if I'm desiring to do it, there's a pretty good chance it's not the thing to do. If my flesh is desiring to do it, it's probably a good indicator. It might not be something that I should do. On the flip side of that, if God is leading me to do something that I don't really want to do, that's probably a good sign as God. All right. But if you're led by the Spirit, which is to say you're not carnally minded, you're not given over to the deeds of the flesh, if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now, right there, and I'm not going to get into this too much this evening, that's not the point. Are we turning the fans down or the lights down? And is there a reason? Camera? Oh, okay. I thought you knew something. Oh, him. Okay. What was I talking about? Law. There you go. Thank you very much. I'm going to have to lay down the law. Anyway, if you're led by the Spirit, you're not under the law, he says. I would suggest to you that what he's really saying here, kind of hearkening back to things that we've talked about when Paul talked about being under the law, he's talking about being under the condemnation of the law. And who was condemned by the law? Those who were not born again and not governed by the Spirit, right? So I'm going to suggest to you that that's really what he's saying here. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the condemnation of the law, as you would have been had you continued to walk according to the flesh. That's really what he's getting at. So in these verses that we read here in Romans 8, verse 14, what it is highlighting is what the Father's ultimate intention was and is for his people. And the reason you and I were born again, from his perspective anyway, or the reason he wanted us to be born again, the reason he wanted us to come to faith, the reason he wanted us to be reconciled to him, was not just to avoid hell. It was not just that. That's a pretty good, you know, provocation. But it was more than that. His ultimate intention was to have sons and daughters. You know, the negative side of things, you know, going to hell, spending eternity separated from God, you know, that's bad. That is definitely a negative aspect of this. But it seems to me that he is, I'll try to get it out here, accentuating the positive. He wants sons and daughters. That's his goal. And so then that should be our goal too. Not just to avoid an eternity separated from God, but to strive for an eternity joined to God, to be sons and daughters, to be children of God. That is why Yeshua came. That is why he came and atoned for our rebellion, so that we could be given the power, the right, the ability to become the children of God, so that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. In fact, let me see if I can think of the words I want to use here. When I was a kid growing up in a fiery Pentecostal church, the way I remember it anyway, there was a lot more emphasis on the punishment of not being born again rather than the reward of being born again. That's the way I remember it anyway. And so what I'm trying to say is that from his point of view, the reason Yeshua was sent into this world to die, to be buried, to rise again, was that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. In other words, that God would have many sons and daughters. Because when you go back to the very beginning, the first Adam, who was created in the image and likeness of God, according to the genealogy of the Messiah in Luke chapter 3, you know how it identifies Adam? The son of God. So when he formed Adam, he breathed the breath of life into Adam. The idea here was that he was to be a son of God. Of course, Adam fell, and why? Because he listened to another voice. He was led by another voice. And because he was led by that other voice, he introduced sin and death into the world, which is then why the last Adam, Yeshua, comes to reconcile us back to the Father as his sons and daughters. I'm going to go to another passage that's just going to kind of bolster this idea. And I know you all know this, but in 1 John chapter 3, verse 8, it says, "For this purpose the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil," because the devil wants to, he wants to pull us away from the Creator. He wants to seduce us into following his voice and doing what he says. "And so the Son of God was manifested that he might destroy the works of the devil." And then he says, whoever has been born of God does not sin, for his seed," that is his word, "remains in him." What happens if his word abides in us, right? So his seed remains in him, and he cannot sin because he has been born of God. "In this, the children of God and the children of the devil are manifest." And my point for reading that is the reason behind being born again has always been about becoming the sons and the daughters of God. In Exodus chapter 21, the law concerning the bondservant, I'm sure you're familiar with it. The bondservant after 6 years can go his own way. But if he says in his heart, "I love my master," and he doesn't want to go his own way, what happens? He's brought to the master's door, and his ear is literally attached to the doorpost of the master's home. And then he goes into the master's home to serve him how long? Forever. All right, so considering that, who's going to provide for that servant's family? Who's going to protect that servant from his enemies? We can go on and on and on. The point is this: that servant is now enjoying the benefits of a son. That's the whole idea behind it. He's always wanted to have sons and daughters. And so when the servant of a willing heart comes under the umbrella of his master's house, he enjoys all the benefits of a son. In fact, in John chapter 8, I believe Yeshua is kind of alluding to the laws of the bondservant. Verse 35, he says, "A slave or a servant does not abide in the house forever, but a son abides forever." So again, from the Creator's point of view, redemption, reconciliation, restoration has always been about sons and daughters. The prodigal, when he does return, He says to his father, I'm not worthy to be called your son. I just need to be regarded as a servant. But what does his father say? Nonsense. You are my son. You were dead, now you're alive. You are my son. So you see this theme from beginning to end of Scripture. When Israel was redeemed from Egyptian bondage, they were brought to Sinai. Why? What was the reason? Because earlier, the Creator had told Moses, Israel is my son, my firstborn. Hosea 11, I have called my son out of Egypt. It's, the world has my son. I want my son back. I want my sons and my daughters. That's what his heart is all about. So just as Israel was redeemed from Egypt because he said, that's my son, you and I have been redeemed and we are being led by his spirit. If we are being led by his spirit, we are being led by his spirit to become his children. So going back to something we were talking about this past weekend, the whole idea of drawing near, karav, remember? Which is the root for Korban, which is the offering or the sacrifice. He wants us to draw near into him. And we, I think we talked about this anyway. We mentioned the scripture about who ascends the hill of the Lord and who stands in his holy place. And what is the answer to that? You have to have clean hands and you have to have a pure heart. The Hebrew word that is translated pure is bar, bet resh, bet resh. And that word also means grain. It can mean wheat as well, bar. And so pure, how do you connect that to wheat? Well, here's what I think of, the parable of the wheat and the tares. And in the parable of the wheat and the tares, the wheat are likened unto? Does anybody know? The sons of the kingdom. Remember? And so bar, this word betresh, which means pure, relative to the heart, those who ascend the hill of the Lord, is also the word for wheat. Wheat has a connection to the sons of the kingdom. But by the way, bar is also the Aramaic word for son. You've heard of a bar mitzvah, the son of the commandment. So what I'm getting at is this. Who ascends the hill of the Lord who stands in his holy place? The one who has clean hands and the heart of a son, right? And so that just amplifies, again, God's desire is to have sons and to have daughters, to have children. Now, how many of us have heard, probably all of our lives, that all mankind, everybody, all of us are God's children? Have we heard that? All of our lives. And to some degree, that's true because we were all created in his image and his likeness. But that was true when he created mankind. He created mankind in his image and likeness in the day that he created them. But what happened subsequent to that? Man was led by another voice. Man followed another voice. And when he did that and fell, in that regard, mankind at large anyway, became the enemy of God. That's Bible. We read it last week, James 4 and 4. If you're a friend of the world, what does that make you in relation to God? His enemy. You're at war with him. You're hostile toward him. So, yeah, we were all made in the image and likeness of God in the day that mankind was created. But since that time, some things have changed. And mankind at large made decisions not to be led by spirit, to be led by the flesh, to be led and governed by another voice. Again, making mankind at large the enemy of God, which then is kind of why, for example, in Egypt, God didn't say everybody together are my people. You know, the Egyptians, the Hebrews, everybody all kind of mixed together are all my people, did he? No, he said a division between Israel and Egypt. He distinguished between Israel and Egypt to the point that when plagues were falling on Egypt, not even a dog would raise his head against Israel. He was distinguishing his people from the rest of the world. And so in Scripture, whether we like it or not, you know, it goes against our warm fuzzies and, you know, the kumbaya mentality. But Scripture makes it very clear that God distinguishes between the world and his children. So then, before repentance, what were we? enemies. Before repentance, we were enemies of God. Afterwards, we were invited to become his sons and his daughters, which then leads us to Paul's next thought in verse 15. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption, by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. So Israel was in Egyptian bondage. Likewise, we were once in bondage to sin and to death. And we who were subject to the spirit of bondage now are the recipients of the spirit of adoption, Paul says. In other words, God does not have orphans. God does not have stepchildren. He does not have second-class children. He has children, and he has enemies. It's one or it's the other, right? So if we have been given the spirit of adoption, that means he is our father, and we are his children, becoming his children, being conformed to the image of the Son of God. Psalm 27, verse 10 says this, when my father and my mother forsake me, then the Lord will take care of me. He has a heart toward orphans, doesn't he? And the fatherless, right? Because he wants to be a father to the fatherless. Did I read that somewhere? All right. So he doesn't have orphans. John 14, this is what Yeshua says in verse 16. I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, or some translations say comforter. He will give you another helper that he may abide with you forever. And who is that helper? The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. And this is what I wanted to emphasize. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you. So he was telling his disciples, and by extension you and me, that even though he is not here with us physically, so to speak, maybe that's not the best word to use, you know what I mean though, but yet he is here with us in spirit because he has left his spirit to keep us, to guide us, to lead us, to instruct us, and to not leave us as orphans. He doesn't have orphans. He doesn't have stepchildren. He doesn't have second-class children. He has children. And so then as our father, he looks out for us. He looks out for us. He protects us. He oversees us. And he's not going to lead us to believe. He's not going to lead us to do things that are contrary to his ways. His spirit is going to lead us into truth. And so as his children, when we are being directed, guarded, guided, sometimes chastened, when we are being governed by his spirit, it once again, it demonstrates that we are his. For those who are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. Those who are his will fear him, but those who are his will not live in fear. I want to say that again. Those who are his will fear him, but those that are his will not live in fear. Because I read somewhere else that he has not given us that spirit, right? So the Spirit of God and the spirit of fear are antithetical. They're not the same. He hasn't given us the spirit of fear, but what? Power, okay? Power to do what? To overcome, power to endure, power to not give in to the deeds of the flesh, love. You know, that encompasses a lot of things. A sound mind. A sound mind. As opposed to maybe being double-minded, right? There are religions in this world, some are very prominent in this world, whose adherents live in a constant state of fear about what's going to happen to them when they die. And in fact, I'm not going to name any particular religions, but there is one in particular that their eternal being is dependent on what kind of a mood their God is in on any given day. They can't be certain even if they do all the things that their God instructs them to do and abstains from all the things that he tells them not to do, they still can't be certain that they're going to end up in paradise, which provokes some to become martyrs. Because that seems that that's the only way they can be certain that they can end up in paradise. All right? So I'm suggesting, no, I'm saying outright, that there are religions in this world whose the people who are in those religions live in a constant state of fear and dread. Those who are led by the Spirit of God will fear him. But those who are led by the Spirit of God will not live in fear. All right? As the children of God, we don't have to fear this way. We don't have to live in fear this way because the Messiah has come. He is our rest. He is our safety. He has taken our punishment. He's taken our guilt, all of those things. And so in him, we do not have to fear suffering the wrath of God because according to Scripture, he's reserved that for who? His enemies. And we're not his enemies any longer. We've been given the right, the power, the ability to become the sons of God. 1 Thessalonians 5:9. God did not appoint us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Yeshua the Messiah. So that's what we have. That's that comfort, that security that we have in Yeshua by faith, that we are not appointed into wrath because, again, that is reserved for God's enemies. Before repentance, we were his enemies. Subsequent to repentance, being led by the Spirit, we are becoming the sons and the daughters of God. So, again, we're not appointed unto wrath. And we're not going to talk about the rapture tonight. But even though we're not appointed unto wrath, that doesn't mean that we're exempt from his chastening. There's a big difference there. Wrath and chastening are not the same thing. In fact, chastening is a sign that we are his sons and daughters. If we don't have chastening, if we're not chastened by God, that would identify us as being illegitimate, not sons and daughters. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 5. Have you forgotten the exhortation which speaks to you as to sons? My son, do not despise the chastening of the Lord, nor be discouraged when you are rebuked by him. For whom the Lord loves, he chastens and scourges every son whom he receives. Scourges. I wonder what that means. I mean, let me just meditate on how I want to say this. There are some folks out there who need a good butt whipping. Right? For their own good. I don't guess I should ask if I can say that. I already did. But anyway. He scourges every son whom he receives. And so the writer of Hebrews goes on. He says, if you endure chastening, because some people don't. Some people won't. But if you endure chastening, God deals with you as with sons. So could I deduce from that, that if I refuse the chastening or I'm unwilling or unable to endure it, that I won't be considered a son? For what son is there whom a father does not chasten? But if you are without chastening, of which all have become partakers, then you are illegitimate and not sons. There's the answer to our question. So again, there's a big difference in wrath and chastening. Wrath is reserved for his enemies. Chastening is reserved for his sons. And there's a big difference between the two. And chastening is a sign that we are his sons and daughters. And so then, if we are being chastened, we should try to look beyond the pain of that and consider that this is a sign that he loves me and he considers me to be a son, he considers me to be a daughter, and that's a good thing. So Paul says that bondage, whether it's to Pharaoh, going back to Israel and in Egypt, or whether it's to sin, it results in fear. Those who are in bondage live in fear. Those who are in bondage to whatever it is, it's likely that they live in a state of fear, maybe a fear of God's wrath. But those who have been adopted by him should not live in fear of his wrath. They're going to be subject to chastening. Might as well kind of write it down. It's going to happen. But the chastening should not cause us to fear his wrath because we are his. He loves his children. He loves his sons and daughters. And in fact, he has promised to deliver us from his wrath. So then, we'll move on into the verse. And let's talk about very quickly this idea of adoption. I'm not going to get too detailed, but we have families here in our congregation who have adopted many, and it is a blessing. It incites admiration to see how they adopt these children, take them into their homes, provide for them, and love them as if they were their own flesh and blood. Okay? So when we take that and we apply it to you and I in the eyes of God, this is what it says to me. His being willing to receive us unto himself as sons and daughters, it speaks of his grace to us. It speaks of the fact that he is love, that he is compassionate, he is long-suffering, he is merciful, he is gracious to us. He didn't have to call Israel to be a set-apart nation, but he did. And when he called them to be a set-apart nation, it wasn't because they were the greatest. In fact, let's read in Deuteronomy 7, verse 7. The Lord did not set his love on you, nor choose you, because you were more in number than any other people. In fact, you were the least of all peoples. But because the Lord loves you, and because he would keep the oath which he swore to your fathers, the Lord has brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the house of bondage, from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And so, taking that, connecting it to what Paul says, we have not received the spirit of bondage, again, to fear, to live in fear of oppression and all these things, but we've received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. So just as Israel was chosen not because they were the greatest, but because he loved them, he brought them out from among the nations. Likewise, he chose you and me, those of us who were among the nations. He chose us. He called us. He set us apart because he loves us. What did Yeshua say? You didn't choose me. None of us have chosen him. According to him, he chose us. Because remember, the Spirit of God initiates. He's the one who initiates the process. It is up to us to respond, either yes or no. When Israel was brought to the foot of the mountain, God presents his covenant to them. It's left to them to decide, will we follow it or not? And of course they said, we're going to do that. But again, we didn't choose him, he chose us. And did he choose us because we were the greatest? No. In fact, when he found most of us, we weren't doing so great, right? I know that some of you were born saved, but not all of us were. Right? So when he chose us, we weren't doing so great, but he took us under his wing to care for us and to provide for us. And according to Yeshua, the purpose of this, or one of the reasons for this, he said, you didn't choose me, I chose you. He said, to appoint you to bear much fruit. And I've got a reason for choosing you, and there's something behind this, and it is to produce fruit. And of course, producing fruit is akin to the idea of offspring, making disciples, which is sons and daughters. He wants a family, and he wants a big family. And he wants a family comprised of those who love him with all their heart, their soul, and their strength. And so then he took us under his wing to care for us, for that we would bear fruit, which is to say, to demonstrate his character in the world, not the character of men who are not governed by his spirit, but to demonstrate his character in the earth, which is to demonstrate or to provide evidence that we are being led by his spirit. Now, there are some translations that render the Greek word that is translated adoption. They translate that word as sonship. You have not given us the spirit of fear, the spirit of bondage to fear, but he's given us the spirit of sonship, whereby we might cry out, Abba, Father. Because we once were orphans. We once were strangers. And being orphans and being strangers in relation to God, there's fear that accompanies that. There's uncertainty. What's going to happen? But that's no longer, because we've been chosen by him. We come to him. We are his sons and his daughters. And so we can legitimately call him Abba, Father. The Spirit of God, who Yeshua says is the Spirit of truth, will guide us into all truth, according to John chapter 16. And all truth would include this: who we are, what we are, what it truly means to be in Messiah, our identity, in other words. Pardon me. The parable of the lost sheep, what does that say to you? What does that speak to you? What is the emphasis of that? This is where you can get involved. Mercy, I heard that word. Pursuing. Okay, him pursuing us. Okay. Anybody else? Okay. That's close to what I'm looking for, actually. The point I wanted to make here is he didn't lose the sheep. They were lost, which kind of connects to the idea of they may not really understand who and what they are, who they belong to. They don't really understand and appreciate their identity. Okay? So if the Spirit of God is leading us, and the Spirit of God is the Spirit of truth, and according to Yeshua, the Spirit of truth is going to lead us into all truth. That is going to include teaching us, leading us to understand who we are and what we are in Messiah. In other words, that we're not orphans, we're not second-class citizens, we're sons and daughters of God. Now, again, I know you know all of this, but nevertheless, this is really important. This is kind of the emphasis tonight. We are sons and daughters of God, not because of human DNA, right? We're not the sons and daughters of God because of human DNA, but we're counted as sons and daughters because of faith, the grace of God. Those are the things that identify us as being his. And so we who were far off, according to Paul in Ephesians 2, now been brought near. And so when being brought near to him, when we are in distress, we can cry out to him like a child would cry out to its father, Abba, which, by the way, is technically not Hebrew. Did you know that? Av is the Hebrew word. Abba is actually an Aramaic term, but it's an Aramaic term that means father or dad or daddy or papa, however you want to put it. And it's origins, I guess you'd say, it's a word that would be used by a small child to call out to its father. But then, of course, it morphed into being used by people who weren't small children, because even Yeshua referred to the Heavenly Father as Abba. And so if he referred to him as Abba, that seems to suggest to me, by his own example, that should encourage us to refer to him as Abba, as our Father as well. So let's move on to verse 16 of Romans chapter 8. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Messiah, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. And so, connecting this verse or these verses to the previous one, it seems to suggest this, that when we cry out, Abba, Father, It's the Spirit of God bearing witness that we are his children. We're not referring to him by some distant term. We're referring to him by a very close and intimate term that says we have this very close relationship. And so again, when we cry out, Abba, Father, it is the Spirit bearing witness that we are his, that we are his sons and daughters. Because his enemies wouldn't refer to him as Abba, right? Only those who know him. So this declaration, Abba, Father, it's the Spirit of truth revealing truth to us in regard to who and what we are in Messiah. And who are we? What are we? According to Paul in Ephesians chapter 2, you are no longer strangers, you're no longer foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God. And because it is by the grace of God that we're invited to become his sons and daughters, it must be that the Spirit of God bears witness to our spirit. I guess our spirit can come in agreement with the Spirit of God, but it seems to me that if he initiates things, we respond. And so when we cry out, Abba, Father, it's the Spirit of God bearing witness to our spirit, assuring us that we are his sons and his daughters. Does that make sense to you? In other words, we're prompted by the Spirit of God to call him Abba. The Spirit of God is encouraging us to call him Abba, because if he sees us as sons and daughters, wouldn't he want us calling him Abba? Right? On that note, I want you to consider something, and this might spark a little conversation. I knew my dad for 53 years. Never once did I call him by his name, Bill. Not one time. I always called him Dad. When I was little, Daddy. When I was a teenager, and for the rest of his life, I called him Pop. I never once said, hey, Bill. Listen to what I'm saying. He who has an ear. He is our king. Yes. He is the righteous judge. Absolutely. He is the redeemer. He's all of those things and many other things. But it seems to me that what he desires is sons and daughters, and that we would regard him as Abba. Do you hear what I'm saying? My dad's friends called him by his name. His children called him Pop. So according to Paul, as children, we are also heirs. Heirs of the promises that are made to all who are his. And the word heir, H-E-I-R, is a word that should prompt us to look not just at the present, but the word heir prompts us to look into the future, because we are heirs according to the promise in Galatians 3. So consider, you and I have been redeemed. We are being redeemed. We will be redeemed. Agreed? Because there's still another component of this redemption process that is yet to take place in any of us. And that is, this body is still mortal. This body is still corruptible. And that has to change. This body has to be redeemed. So we have been redeemed. We're being redeemed. We will be redeemed. And to be redeemed in the future, as it relates to the future, as sons and daughters, that means that's when all the promises are realized. Now, I realize that we have promises in this existence, in this life, but you understand what I mean. When the redemption, lift up your heads, for your redemption draws near. He's talking about redeeming the nation at large, redeeming all of his people, bringing them into the fruition of the promise that is made to Israel. And so as heirs, we look toward the future. We look toward the promises that he will deliver to us, that we will realize as a people, individually, but as a people as well. And if we're looking to a future that we cannot see right now, that connects us to another word. Can anybody guess what it is? Yeah, faith. I'm looking for another word, actually. Hope. Thank you. Because do you hope for things you can see? No. You hope for what you cannot see, right? And so if we're looking towards something, we know it's real. We know he's made the promise. We know it will happen. But yet we can't hold it right now. We can't grasp it right now. We look ahead for it. And so that prompts us to hope. Genesis 49:18. Jacob said this, I have waited for your salvation, O Lord. And the word waited literally means looked very earnestly or hoped. I have hoped, I've looked for, I'm anticipating, I'm expecting Yeshua Techa, by the way, Yeshua Techa, your salvation. I'm looking, I'm anticipating that. And so likewise, as heirs, because we're sons and daughters of God, we're also heirs. So we look with anticipation to the fruition of the promise that he's given to us. We are hoping, looking to receive the inheritance that our Father has promised to us. Because that's what a father does, right? He leaves an inheritance to his children. And so, of course, he doesn't die and pass that along to us. But yet he has given us an inheritance. He's given us something, a promise has been made to us that as his sons and daughters, we look ahead to. You know, even though many of us in this congregation and others like it weren't born ethnically Israeli, nevertheless, when we came into this covenant, we came into this family, we became heirs to the same promise that was made to the seed of Abraham. So we have that anticipation, we have that hope, we have that expectation. Why? Because those who have emulated the faith of Abraham, which, by the way, was accounted unto him as righteousness, are the same people who are being led by the Spirit of God. And being led by the Spirit of God means what? You're the sons of God, right? For those who are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. And being considered sons of God, that means that we are partakers of the promises that were given to Abraham and to his seed. In other words, it's not necessarily because of who they are as much as it is who they have become. I'm not the same person I was before all of this started. I'm a different person. Doesn't mean I'm a different person. And I am being conformed to the image of the Son of God. Again, not because of human DNA, but because of faith. I'm going to go back to Galatians, even though we're not studying the book of Galatians. It just kind of pairs up with what we're talking about right now. Galatians chapter 3, verse 26 and 29. You are all sons of God through faith in Messiah, Yeshua. In verse 29, it says, and if you are Messiah's, then you are Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. So again, it's through this relationship with God through covenant that was made possible by and through the Messiah, we have become sons and daughters of God. Consequently, we have become heirs to the kingdom, heirs of the kingdom that Yeshua is going to rule and reign. We're going to be part of that. We're going to be participants in that. That is part of our inheritance. We are going to be priests and we're going to be rulers in the kingdom. We are going to reign with him. We're not going to reign beside him. We're going to reign with him, under his kingship. And so that aspect is part and parcel of the promise that was made to Abraham and to his seed. Messiah is the seed, but we are in him. And so it's only logical that we would be heirs with him. And so then, the fruition of the covenantal relationship is to realize, not to be aware of, but to realize, to come into and to possess the promise that was made with that covenant. But with every, pardon me, got a little tickle in my throat. If there's one handy, but don't go to a whole lot of trouble. So the realization of the promise goes hand in glove with the giving of the covenant, but also with that covenantal relationship and the promise that it gives us, there comes a price. There comes a responsibility. To be joint heirs, thank you, to be joint heirs with the Messiah, according to Paul, means that we have to be willing to join in his suffering, which I will suggest kind of goes back to that whole chastening thing. It's maybe not exactly the same, but it's kind of related, because chastening usually means it hurts, right? When my dad took off his belt, it hurt. When my mama chased me with a switch, if she could catch me, it hurt. So it kind of goes hand in glove as far as I'm concerned. So again, the promise, the relationship, you know, all of these wonderful things comes with a price. And according to Paul, we have to be willing to join in his suffering if we want to be joint heirs. In fact, the suffering, like the chastening, is evidence that we are his sons and daughters. How many of you like to suffer? Let me see your hands. Nobody likes to suffer. But yet, again, that suffering is evidence that we are his sons and daughters. So that's a difficult one to wrap your brain around, but it is. Because I don't like to see my kids suffer. And I'm not saying he likes to see his kids suffer, but he has a perspective that you and I don't have right now. He sees things through the lens of eternity. We only see what's right in front of us, right? So we don't like to see our kids suffer. But then there are those times it's needful, right? They have to learn some things. They have to learn some hard lessons. And it hurts, and it's painful, and you want to step in and rescue them, and sometimes that's the worst thing you could possibly do, right? So he allows that because he understands the significance, the need for it. But there is a reward. There's a payoff. Because if we are suffering with him, it's so that we might be glorified together with him. And that's something to look forward to. That's something to hope for. That's something to look toward with great expectation. But it, you know, we can't get around it. If we want to be glorified together with the Messiah, and we all want to participate in that, right? Okay. Then that requires that we're going to have to suffer with him. All right, I'm going to go over to Peter, 1 Peter chapter 4. I'm going to read verses 1 and 2, and then I'll skip down to verse 12. Since Messiah suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same mind. All right, so when I read that, kind of thought, stopped, paused, thought about that, meditated upon that just a moment, had to read it again. Since Messiah suffered for us in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same mind. So it seems to me that what Peter's saying here is we have to be resolved to the fact that being led by the Spirit of God will require us to suffer. He suffered in the flesh, so we need to arm ourselves with the same mind. We need to make up our mind. If we're following the Messiah, he suffered, we're going to suffer. That's just the way it is. For he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin. And so Peter makes it very plain here. Part of the reason we have to suffer is because that flesh that wants to be satisfied has to be put to death. It has to realize that it can't get its way. That he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh for the lusts of men, but for the will of God. That's why we suffer. That's why we have to be willing to suffer. And then going down to verse 12. Do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you. In other words, that says to me, this is something you should expect. And when it happens, you shouldn't say, why is this happening? Which is exactly what we say, right? Why is this happening? God, why are you allowing this to happen? You know, all these other things. Peter's saying this really shouldn't be strange to you. It should be expected. But he says, but rejoice to the extent that you partake of Messiah's sufferings. And so if God allows suffering to touch my life, it's because he's allowing me to identify with the Messiah in his sufferings. Because he wasn't a real popular guy, come to think of it, right? And yeah, people followed him around for the bread and the fish. Things like that, right? Oh yeah, they would show up when they wanted to get healed. But where were all those people when he was in the midst of his suffering? Even those closest to him, what did they do? The ones who said, I will die for you, they ran off and hid. So when we suffer, when God allows us to suffer, and I'm not talking about consequences of our bad choices necessarily, but when God allows us to suffer for righteousness' sake, he's allowing us to identify with the Messiah in that regard. And Peter says that we should rejoice to the extent that we partake of Messiah's sufferings. Now, I will admit that when I'm in the midst of suffering, my first and initial reaction and thought is not to rejoice. It hasn't been so far. I would really like to get to the place that maybe that one day, maybe one day, I would rejoice. Not there yet. But nonetheless, Peter says that, you know, rejoice to the extent that you partake of Messiah's sufferings, that when his glory is revealed, you may also be glad with exceeding joy. So somehow or another in this, either he's talking about if we endure these things, that in this, there's going to come a point in all of this suffering that his glory is going to be revealed to us, in us, and that we're going to be really happy to see that. We're going to be overjoyed to see his glory revealed in us and through us because we've endured all these things. So he either means that or that when all this is said and done and we see him face to face, it's going to be worth it. Or he might be saying both, because both, I think, are true. But again, when we suffer, those things that God allows us or allows to touch our lives, we identify with the suffering of the Messiah. We identify him with him in that regard. And if we suffer with him, Paul says we're going to be glorified together with him. So we're almost done here for tonight. The primary reason for suffering is to render death to the deeds of the flesh, to put to death the flesh. So that in that regard, if we are to be considered the sons and daughters of God, then we have to resign ourselves to the fact that suffering is mandatory. When we suffer, because it's supposed to put to death the deeds of the flesh, that suggests to me that we will most often notice it in our flesh. When my flesh is hurting, when my flesh is uncomfortable, when my flesh is screaming to be soothed and comforted, that's a pretty good sign that God is allowing something to touch my life that is needful. Because he's never going to speak to me in a way that is going to soothe my flesh. Never. He's never going to speak to me in a way that coddles my flesh and my soulish man. He's going to speak to me in a way that challenges all those things to die. As the Spirit leads us, as he matures us, our perspective changes. All right. Our typical initial reaction to any kind of suffering is, why? Why are you letting this happen? Peter's suggesting that our maturing process should bring us to the place of, I am identifying with the suffering of the Messiah, and I know he's going to bring something good out of this. And so if we do mature in this journey, our perspective should change. Should change. And if it's not, we need to assess some things. If it's all about us, what I want, what I need, what I feel, da-da-da-da-da, there's some maturing yet to do. And I know that all of us have some maturing yet to do. But it should be that if the Spirit of God is leading us, then the Spirit of God is causing us to mature in the Messiah, our perspective of things should change. We should be more spirit than flesh. Right? All right. So I'm going to close with these thoughts that Paul had. Same issue, same topic, but he's addressing the congregation of the Philippians. And so in chapter 3 of Philippians, verse 11, he says this. But what things were gained to me, things that would soothe the flesh, things that would cause the flesh to be proud and all that, what things were gained to me, these I have counted loss for the Messiah. Yet indeed, I also count all things loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Messiah Yeshua, my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish. Why? That I may gain Messiah and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is from the law, but that which is through faith in Yeshua the Messiah, the righteousness which is from God by faith. And here's what we want to emphasize, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, if by any means I may attain to the resurrection from the dead. And so it seems to me that what Paul, if I boiled that down, what he's saying is to be raised incorruptible from the dead, to be glorified with the Messiah is worth more than anything that this world could offer us. Anything that pertains to the flesh that's soothing, that puffs us up, that makes us feel good, all of those things that we, you know, tend to gravitate toward. Paul is saying to know that I will be raised incorruptible and will be glorified with the Messiah. That's the goal. That's more important than anything. And so the maturing process should bring us to the place that we look at the things that we used to embrace, that we used to love, that we used to crave. We need to mature to the place that we look at those things as rubbish, garbage. That's what he's saying. Those things that we crave and desire that pertain to this world should become things that we would not climb into a dumpster to retrieve. If it's in a dumpster, it's probably nasty, right? It's discarded. And it's not something that we really want to go and, you know, jump in there and retrieve. That's what Paul is saying. All those things that I used to think were so important, they're in the dumpster now. And there's no way I'm going in to get them because there's something more important. I've matured to the place that I realize to be raised incorruptible, to be glorified with Messiah, overwhelms any other thing that I might desire. So I'm going to close with this verse and we'll pick up at this place next time we come together, which it's verse 18 of Romans 8 is going to echo what he just said here to the Philippians. Verse 18, for I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. It's not even worth mentioning in the same sentence with the glory that's going to be revealed in us, is what he's saying. It's rubbish. It's nothing. It comes to nothing. There's nothing that can compare to the glory that's going to be revealed in us if we endure these sufferings that we might be glorified together with him. So, you know, I wish, boy, I have to say this again. You know, Paul was a smart guy. That's obvious. But to have that kind of insight and wisdom and then be able to put it into words, to express it to other people, whereby they might be edified and learn and grow. Obviously, this man was writing under the inspiration of the Spirit of God. that he talks about, being led by the Spirit of God to write these things down, whereby you and I, 2,000 years later, are talking about these things, encouraged by these things, challenged by these things, right? Amen. So we will pause there, and if the next 12, 15 minutes or so, we have anybody who wants to ask a question, make a comment regarding it. Makaja, I'm going to call on you today. Do you mind? Do you mind helping me? Okay. You needed to wake up?
Yes. All of that.
Yes. Okay. All right. So does anybody have anything they would like to share and add to this conversation tonight? If we have any comments or questions from online, we could pull those up as well. All right. Let's kind of keep it on topic, if we wouldn't. And if you don't have anything to say, we'll turn out the lights and we'll go home. All right.
Hey. Thank you.
Yeah. Every time I threaten to stop, somebody raises their hand.
Oh, goodness. Hi there, everyone.
Yes, ma'am.
I want to talk about the fact of how God buffets us in the sense that I've faced some things, I guess this week, and one of them was God had to remind me, did you not say that you trust me, that I'm going to provide for you, that I'm going to watch over you? And then, of course, whenever I'm paying attention now to see where I'm being tested so I can move away from my only thinking of I got to fix this, I got to do this, I got to do that. And then, so the Holy Spirit, whatever you said about when you said that, it was about how God is he always testing us and saying, let me see, we got to keep getting this test over and over. Different circumstances happen, different things happen. So I had to be man, I'm so sorry. And it's we always got to be I'm quick to repent and quick to acknowledge that I am not listening at the moment when the trial comes. So the Holy Spirit is yes, here we go. We got to get you trained in this area, that I am taking care of you, that I am going to provide for you no matter what. And do not look at what other people are doing or whatever you think you need to do. You need to look to me. And it made me feel bad because I was looking and I was worried. And I was wondering, what am I going to do in that sense? And I'm I was called differently. I wasn't called to be like everyone else. I was called to serve God in a different manner. And then I think that was the moment where the enemy tried to make me think that, oh, man, this. And I'm man, that is hard. It's hard because you say in the flesh, you worry, what does people think? Do they think I'm lazy or something? And then I'm the Holy Spirit is calling me for something else that is not like anyone else. And I'm Lord, I don't ever want to change that. I don't care what it is. I will sleep in my car if I have to. The point is, I know he won't let me do that, but the point is that he reminds me over and over. So he's going to always teach us and tell us, look, there, it might look like this. You don't know what's going on there, but I called you for a different purpose. So I just wanted to, tell the Lord, I am sorry, and I will keep focus from now on until the next test. Amen. Okay.
All right. Thank you. I was told by a fellow believer in Yeshua that the law cannot work alongside grace. Could you please address this? Thanks, Bill. I would say that the answer is somewhat dependent on how they're looking at the law. We've been talking about for weeks, Paul addressing those who looked at the law. If they did this, they don't do that, they could in some way attain justification because of their own merit. And he absolutely says that's not the way to go about it. You're leaning on the flesh, that leads to death. So people who looked at the law in that regard didn't see the grace, the mercy, the faith, and all those things. But those of us who understand what grace is and that God has invited us to pitch our tent next to his so that he can show us how we, a better way to live, and he does that through his law. He does that through his commandments. So to say that grace can't work alongside his commandments, well, I don't know how else to say it. It's ridiculous. In where do we first see grace? Where did we see the word? Where do we see the concept? We don't see it showing up in the New Testament, not for the first time. We see it showing up in the very beginning. Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. You know, so there is this idea that if we are invited into the relationship due to God's grace, and that in answering that call, you know, turning from our way before, being a new creation, to and that being our state, to say that we now cannot work with what God said to do and not to do is ridiculous. I mean, you might as well just take everything that comes left of Matthew. It's the, if that's your thinking, you may as well take everything that comes left of Matthew and throw it away. If it doesn't work with that, you might as well throw it away. But notice that when you do that, you're going to have to throw away a lot of the New Testament, a lot of the things that Yeshua said, the things that Paul said, things that Peter said, things that John said. You're going to have to extract all of that if you do away with that. And so it's a unfortunate theological position that has just been kind of propagated through the centuries, and it is very, very deeply entrenched in people's minds and hearts. Paul has been grossly misunderstood, grossly mistranslated, misinterpreted, which is one of the reasons that we've been, you know, for 28 sessions going through the book of Romans to try to better understand these things. So, there's a lot of things that we could get into. We could be talking about this for the rest of the night. But if someone is approaching the law as their means to be justified before God, then yeah, that doesn't jive with the whole idea of grace and faith and repentance and new creation and those kinds of things. But if we understand that Israel was redeemed out of Egypt because they placed their trust in the blood of a lamb, then he brought them to the foot of Mount Sinai to teach them what to do. If you will indeed hear my voice and keep my covenant, then you shall be a kingdom of priests, a holy nation, you know, this peculiar treasure unto me. And so the redemption, the deliverance, the salvation, the relationship comes first. He initiated that. Then he brought them to Sinai and says, now here's how I want you to live. That's the way it works. So I'll leave it at that. Where's the mic? Where am I at? Anybody have the microphone? Yes. It's not on, Lori. It's not on.
That's there it goes. It took a minute. going back to what you were saying about, well, what the Bible says about we are chosen. Do you think that means that some are actually born for destruction?
I have a hard time believing that God created somebody to be evil. I have a hard time believing that God, who is love, created somebody to be bad. The fact that he goes to Pharaoh, he knows what's in Pharaoh's heart. Nevertheless, he gives Pharaoh an opportunity to repent. He gives him opportunity. You know, he's not willing that any should suffer, right? Because he's long-suffering. He's not willing that any should perish because he's long-suffering. So if he's not willing that any should perish, that has to mean that he's not willing that any should perish, that everybody should be given an opportunity to turn. And it, in Ezekiel, I can't remember the address right now, but he talks about he doesn't find any joy in the destruction of the wicked. His heart is that they would turn from their evil way and be delivered from that. So Cain, you know, he was of the wicked one, according to 1 John 3. But why? Not because God made him that way. But he chose to be that way. Many are called, few are chosen. That could be rendered, all are called, but few choose to answer the call. So, no. I personally do not believe that somebody is, you know, created just for the purpose of being evil and wicked and to be destroyed. I believe that there are those that, you know, God knows their heart. He knows what's lurking in that heart, and they've made choices along the way. And so, yeah, he will, okay, I'm going to use you. Pharaoh, you've hardened your heart. Now I'm going to harden your heart, and I'm going to use you to demonstrate my power and my glory. But I think it goes back to, you know, Pharaoh made some choices first. You know, Cain made some choices. Esau made choices. Jacob I have loved, Esau I have hated. But why? It's because Esau first despised his birthright. Esau despised the ways of the Lord. So I have a hard time reconciling a God who is long-suffering, abundant in goodness and mercy, not willing that any should perish, with the notion that he creates somebody, I'm going to create you to be evil so I can destroy you. I can't buy that.
So would you see it more like God's foreknowledge is what causes us to be chosen, because he gives the opportunity to everyone, but his foreknowledge actually knows who is going to choose him.
He knows our hearts.
Makes you chosen.
He knows our hearts because we've demonstrated those things to him in times past. He's telling Moses, I know that Pharaoh will not let you go unless, you know, it's by a strong hand. He knows that. How does he know that? He observes mankind. He observes what's going on in the world. He knows the hearts of man, right? And so in that regard, yes. When he knows our heart, you know, he knows what he gave me when he created me. He knows what he breathed into me. I still have to make a choice though, right? But that, again, many are called, few are chosen, could probably, and maybe should probably be rendered, all are called. It's just that few choose to answer the call. Because when his countrymen and his friends refused to come to the wedding feast, what did he do? Told his servants to go out into the highway and the byway and just get whoever. Call them all in, right?
Yep.
So what does that say? He appeals to all. For God so loved
the world.
That he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever should believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Again, you take all of those things and you connect them all together. It, to me anyway, it states overwhelmingly that God doesn't want anybody to perish. And he didn't create people just to be destroyed. People make choices. And then he says, okay, I'm going to point you to this. You've already shown me what you got. You already showed me what you are, so I'm going to point you to this, that, or the other.
Thank you. I agree with you, by the way. It's a subject that is conversationally difficult to have sometimes because, you know, just explaining the points, I needed a little extra padding there. So I appreciate your other examples because that's helpful.
Again, I think through the centuries, Paul has been grossly misunderstood, you know. Now, I'll put this little footnote on it. We live in a finite world. We have finite understanding. We can't possibly comprehend, you know, the mind of God in its totality because it has no beginning, it has no end. And so there are some things that we probably really can't speak to or shouldn't speak to with, you know, as if we have gotten it all figured out. But what I do know about him flies in the face of the idea that he is just, you know, this person never had any hope. I can't buy that.
Good.
All righty. Anybody else real quick before we pray? What if your family hated you for your sins and now they hate you for They hate you for wanting them to be saved. And they can't accept what looks like hypocrisy to an outsider. What if your family hated you for your sins and now they hate you for wanting them to be saved? They can't accept what looks like hypocrisy to an outsider. I'm not really absolutely certain of what you're saying in that last part. But as it relates to the first part, when we live, you know, when we are born again, some of the hardest people to convince that it's real are family because they know us. I mean, when Saul of Tarsus has this experience on the road to Damascus and he's blind and Ananias has been, he's been told to go and talk to this guy. He's like, well, yeah, but that's Saul, you know? And so some of the early believers had to be convinced that Saul of Tarsus or Paul truly was born again. That's why fruits of repentance are really important. None, you know, back to the point. Again, family are usually the hardest to convince. But then when you live a life that consistently at least strives to walk the way that God has set before us, that's an indictment. And you don't even have to say a word. You don't have to say anything, and probably shouldn't, quite honestly, in some cases. But it is an indictment, because now you used to be that way and you were bad and all this. Now you're born again, you're different. Oh, you think you're better than us, huh? You know, all these kinds of things. How many of you have heard that one before? All right. And no, I don't think I'm better than you. I'm just trying to live a different life. But that's an indictment, because there's an old saying that misery loves company, right? Well, the idea or the concept applies to this. People who don't want to change their ways want everybody to do the things they do. So they don't feel the challenge or the indictment to live a different life. So what you're asking is, what if? Well, that happens all the time. It's a lot of people in this room are nodding their head. Yeah, I know what that's like, right? So it happens. I'm not absolutely certain what you're trying to say in that last part, and they can't accept what looks like hypocrisy to an outsider. I'm not following you there, so I'm not going to address that. But I hope I helped you in some way. All right, one more, and then we're going to pray, and we're going to go home. Sir.
Sir, this was too precious for me not to share, and I hope I express it correctly. What you're sharing about suffering and as sons of God, we're going to have to go through that. I felt something. Suffering isn't a side effect of being a son of God. It's actually a flagstone toward holiness. And suffering isn't something that's, it's not a symptom of pursuing God and walking in the Spirit. It's actually a pushing factor. And all we have to do is look at the example of Yeshua's life. And if he didn't suffer, then he would not have received the crown of glory, because he cried out to God in tears, "Take this from me, but your will be done. You know, let this cup be removed from me," and yet it wasn't. And he was so obedient as a son of God unto death on the cross that as an obedient son walking in the Spirit, he was obedient unto the death on the cross. And looking at that as the example for our lives, then obviously you can only assume that suffering is a flagstone toward holiness, it is a paving stone toward holiness. And without suffering, there is no hope for inheritance. Because if Yeshua cried out for deliverance from the trial of the cross and wasn't, he went through it and he was, what happened to him? 3 days and three nights, he rose again, and he ascended into heaven, and that's what we have to look forward to, but it didn't come without the suffering. So if he's the example for our lives, then that's what we get to walk out every day. So just when it comes to our mindset on suffering and what we get to go through as sons of God, walking in the Spirit, I think to me, just as James points out, when suffering leads to the testing of our faith, which leads to patience and perseverance, you're not going to get to the end without patience, perseverance, and quiet solidarity, awaiting the redemption of this broken and fallen body. So I don't know. I just thought that was really precious. I would share it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I'm still not going to pray for patience, though. I don't have to. That's exactly right. I won't have to. He will have his way in that regard. All right. Are all of our little ones and young people back in? Everybody's good? All righty. Well, with that, I think we'll call it a night, and we'll pray. Where's the microphone? You still have it? Well, Makaja, why don't you come up here, and let's all stand, and you lead us in prayer as we dismiss, okay?
Stand up here?
Yeah, up here. Okay. Let everybody see you.
Abba, thank you for tonight that we were able to learn a little bit more about you and a little bit more about this walk that we're on. Keep us safe as we go out, and keep us safe the rest of this week as we look forward to Shabbat. In your name, amen.
Amen. Everybody be blessed, be safe, be praying for one another, encourage one another, strengthen one another. We'll see you on Shabbat.